Okay, welcome to this video. Let me rewind to the start of the text here, in which we'll talk about the differences between the Schrödinger and the Heisenberg pictures of interpreting the time evolution of quantum systems. So in the fourth postulate, we introduced time evolution through a unitary operator, U, that depends on the time t0 that we start from and the time t that we evolve to. So this describes time evolution in a reversible way, so that's different from the kind of changes to the quantum system that we get through measurement actions. So this is time evolution in a reversible way through the actions of a Hamiltonian or the actions of the energy and the evolution in the system. So in particular, for a time-independent Hamiltonian, we could write this unitary operator as an exponential with the Hamiltonian as a number multiplied with the time that has passed since time t0. So using this unitary operator, we could write our quantum state phi at a time t as this unitary operator working on the state of the system at time t0. So this allows us then to write the state at any time t in the future after t0, or in the past if no measurements occur. Based on this time-evolved state of the system, we can then write the expectation value for any operator, any Hermitian operator that is corresponding with some physical observable. And for this derivation, we'll assume that this is a time-independent operator. So the expectation value of A for this field phi at a time t is given by the inner product of phi with A and phi. And if we write our fields phi at a time t on both the Bra and the Ket side, in terms of the operator U working on those fields, then we'll have a U dagger A U between phi at times t0 and phi at times t0. So I'm introducing this additional description or this additional expression here to draw the contrast between the Schrödinger picture and the Heisenberg picture of interpreting this time evolution. So in the Schrödinger picture, which is what we've used until now, we think of this of the states as the object that varies with time. So in this expression phi at time t with A and phi at time t, the state is the thing that is varying with time, that is time dependent. The operator itself, which I've chosen here to be explicitly time independent, remains time independent. There's no time dependence that this operator has. It is an operator, it is what it is, and it's the fields that change with time. We could, however, also introduce this U dagger A U combination as a time dependent operator. So if we introduce A sub H, which now depends on time through U, through U dagger and U, then we'll be able to write the expectation value of A with the field phi at a time t, which is the same expression I had here, as now the expectation value of this operator A sub H, the Heisenberg picture operator corresponding with this linear operator A, but now between phi at times t0. So in this Heisenberg picture, we're now interpreting the states as being time independent, so phi doesn't change with time, but what does change is this operator A sub H. So the operators pick up a time dependence, but the states remain time independent. So it's a different way of looking at the same time evolution, and one way to think about it could be that this unitary operator U dagger A U, that product or that combination of terms is something we've looked at before when we looked at how operators are changed when we go from one unitary or one orthonormal basis to another orthonormal basis. So U would then describe the basis transformation at a time t. And so we're thinking of this expression, or we could think of this as something that describes the operator A in some basis that has changed with from time t0 to t. So that change of basis could be interpreted as this unitary operator. And so if there is a change of basis, then we would have to write or operator in a different way using this expression. And so that's how we can interpret this Heisenberg picture and how this time dependence gets introduced in our operators. So in this expression, I've used a time-independent A. We started off by writing our Hamiltonian, which was time-independent, so we could actually write the unitary operator as an exponential of that Hamiltonian. But this does also work in a more general way, and so if we look at both time-dependent operators A and time-dependent Hamiltonian H, then we can more generally derive an expression that gives us the total time derivative of this Heisenberg operator A sub H in terms of the commutator with the Hamiltonian. Again, the Hamiltonian transformed using U dagger H U to an H sub H. And then there's additional explicit time dependence due to the explicit time dependence of the operator A. So now if we have this entire expression, which we've derived in the Heisenberg picture, which we can show in the Heisenberg picture, we now go back to an explicitly time-independent operator A, then that last term disappears, and we can compare the left-hand side and the first term on the right-hand side with the Ehrenfest theorem, which we derived in the Schrödinger picture, and which gave us the total time dependence of the expectation value for a field phi at time t. And again, that was given by 1 over I h bar, and then the expectation value of the commutator. So just as in the Heisenberg picture here, we see that this time dependence of an operator at a time t is given by the commutator with the Hamiltonian. That is something that has its parallels in the Ehrenfest theorem when we look at the time dependence now of the expectation value, because the operator, of course, does not have a time dependence, but the time dependence in the Schrödinger picture is introduced through the expectation values and through the fields. So these two pictures are something to keep in mind: the Heisenberg picture, where the states are time independent and the operators are time dependent, and then the Schrödinger picture, where the operators do not change, but it's the states that evolve and change from time to time. Okay. In our applications, we've mainly worked with in the Schrödinger picture. I don't think we've worked in the Heisenberg picture at all. But you might see the Heisenberg picture come up in future applications. So at least for now, we'll mainly use the Schrödinger picture, where the states are the thing that includes the time dependence. Okay, this much for the difference between the Heisenberg and the Schrödinger picture, and we'll continue on in the next videos with tensor products of two vector spaces. So stay tuned for that.